Hello, everybody. Today we have come together to talk about the role of women as a group in the electoral politics in India. It is seen that more and more women are coming forward to vote, and the numbers are increasing in every elections. This trend of increasing women participation and more women coming together and enthusiastically participating in elections really makes us wonder if it has to do at all with the ruling government, something to with the policies by the ruling government. From the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao Yojana to Swachh Bharat Mission to nation's first ever menstrual hygiene protocol to banning commercial surrogacy, the Modi government has been seen to give effect to the Nari Shakti. So today we have Tanya, who's a master's student of public policy, Vinoda, who's pursuing her undergrad degree in political science from Ashoka, Sushmita, who's again a master's student of public policy, Ryosha, who's a second year undergrad student studying maths and political science, and Arjun, who's also a public policy student at Jindal. So coming to the public policies, the Beti Padhao, Beti Bachao Yojana can be best exemplified by the surge in the sex ratio at birth in Haryana from 871 in 2015 to 914 in 2017 for every 1,000 males. And we even see that districts like Yamunanagar and Panipat have also seen a tremendous increase in the sex ratio at birth. Not only that, the WHO data shows that the maternal mortality rates has fallen from 215 in 2010 to 174 in 2015. Moreover, we saw an ordinance bill being passed in 2018, which brought amendments to the POXO Act, which ensured death penalty being given to or life imprisonment to the rapists. And also, for a very long time, as we all know, due to unavailability of toilets, people would be defecating in open spaces. And this was worse for women because they couldn't go out until dark or before, and they or they had to go before dawn, which and they had to also then bear the discomfort of not being able to defecate, which would lead to a breeding point for various diseases. After the Swachh Bharat Mission, 11 crore toilets were built in rural areas, and it was seen that there was a dramatic fall in heinous crimes such as rape, heinous crimes like rape in the rural sector. Not only this, even illegal IVF and surrogacy clinics were mushrooming in the rural areas, who would target and exploit women of economically weaker sections by running a rent-a-womb business. This was stopped by banning commercial surrogacy, and now it can only be done by Indian couples who have been married for 5 years. Also, in order to make the women independent, they are now being provided opportunities for skill development, employment, digital literacy, health, nutrition by the Mahila Shakti Kendra, which was launched in 2017 for this very purpose. Their community engagement has been over 115 backward districts. Even working women hostels were launched to provide safe and convenient accommodation to working women and single mothers, along with daycare facilities. The banning of triple talaq was yet another bold move by the center, which was welcomed by many. And there has been discussions also that to increase the marriageable age from 18 to 21 for women. Coming to politics, we see that for the first time we have women holding the prime positions, whether it was Nirmala Sitharaman being the first full-time defense minister or Smriti Irani being the women minister of the largest industry, which is the textile industry in India. So this is something which is India is seeing for the first time. And after the cabinet renewal this some months back, we have 17 women ministers in the cabinet, and which is one of the highest in the last 17 years. However, despite so many improvements and changes and women empowerment, I just wonder why our women representation is so low. It's just 7% today, as compared to which 25% during 2014 under the Modi government. So, yeah, these are my thoughts.
You know, Garima, you were talking about how more and more women are coming forward to vote. And I think that this is really significant, right? Because you're right, more and more women are showing up to vote. In fact, in the 2019 Lok Sabha elections, women marginally outstripped the women who showed up to vote, marginally outstripped the men who showed up to vote. And what this means is, as more and more women come out to vote, political parties need to cater to women. They need to have more women-centric policies and manifestos, and that's important. So women don't necessarily vote as a bloc, so they don't vote as women, but it is obviously more complicated than that. But as more and more come out, they obviously are gaining electoral significance and power. Also, you know, you were talking about the BJP's policies, and the BJP traditionally has not done too well with women. But this was not true for the 2019 election. In the 2019 election, women overwhelmingly supported Modi. In fact, 46% of the women who came out to vote voted for Modi versus 27% for Congress and 27% for other parties, right? That's a significant amount. And it's, in fact, more than the men that voted for BJP. And Lok Niti did a survey, and they believe that the women-centric policies had at least a proportional effect on this electoral success, largely because when they did the survey, the main policies and programs that were supported or preferred was the Ujjwal Yojana, which is largely directed at women, but also policies you talked about, like the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, the Jal Dhan Yojana, the Mantri Awas Yojana, and the Beti Bachao Beti Padhao Yojana, all of which are largely women-centric.
Okay. I concur and acknowledge what my mates have said. We all have witnessed a stark difference in the female vote share and the female candidates who stand for elections and the female candidates who eventually win the elections. And in my section, I would like to bring your attention to the implementation of BJP-led women-centric government schemes in three northern states, Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, and Assam, and the number of female candidates floated for the seats at the representative state assemblies. I will conclude by talking about the psychology of voters towards female candidates who stand for the elections. Let us look at Bihar first. Let me ask you all a question. How many of you can name a female face in Bihar elections? None, right? Last year, BJP-JDU combined won the Bihar elections, and the Nitish Kumar government became the chief minister for the fourth consecutive year. Interestingly, Renu Devi replaced Sushil Kumar Bodhi for the post of deputy chief minister. Sheila Mandal also took oath as the transport minister and Lizzie Singh as food and consumer protection minister. But out of 30 council of ministers, we only have three female ministers. Unlike neighboring Uttar Pradesh and West Bengal, Bihar has not seen a woman chief minister with an independent political stature. RJD leader Rabri Devi was not in politics when she was propped up as Bihar CM after Lalu Prasad Yadav was forced to resign over the fraud scam case. The number of women being elected to assembly has always fluctuated. In 2005, only three women candidates managed to win the elections. In 2010, 34 women got elected. In 2015, 28 got elected in a 243-member assembly. Ironically, on the other hand, women voters were the major contributors in the 2020 assembly elections, a state in which 50% of the voters are women. In the 2020 Bihar assembly elections, 58.8% of women voters turned out to vote as compared to 52.92% men. Women voters outnumbered men in 166 out of the total 243 assembly constituencies. Of these 166 constituencies, BJP won the maximum seats, that is 55. After the NDA government came to power in Bihar in 2005 to make for these years of neglect, a lot of emphasis was given to women empowerment. The state encouraged women by giving them bigger representation in local administrative bodies and even in Bihar police force. To reduce the gender gap in schools, girls were even provided with free bicycles. Prohibition of liquor has been yet another game changer, which has had a very positive impact on the women of Bihar, which has also reduced domestic violence. 50% of reservation for women in panchayat post in 2006. In June 2020, just before the elections, the Bihar government had launched two ambitious schemes, Mukhyamantri Yuva Udyami Yojana and the Mukhyamantri Mahila Udyami Yojana, to promote entrepreneurship among the young and the women of all sections. In early 2021, the Bihar government wants the quota to get proportionally reflected in the regional administration as well. Hence, every police station, subdivision headquarter, district office, corporation, and the commission in the state will have women appointed in at least 35% of the post. Let's talk about Uttar Pradesh. The Uttar Pradesh government has announced to launch a series of programs aimed at empowering women, which the ruling BJP hoped will help it win more votes from the Adi Abadi, that is the woman, for 2022 assembly elections. The UP government's latest initiative is the move to appoint banking correspondents, called the Sakhis, or the female banking agents, in all 5,08,000 gram panchayats in the state. The state government is raising 3 women provincial armed constabulary at Lucknow, Badau, and Gorakhpur. Its other pro-women schemes include Mukhyamantri Kanya Sumangala Yojana and the Pink Bus Service. On the other hand, BJP gave just 43 female candidates, tickets to just 43 female candidates, and 32 emerged as winners in 2017 elections. There are just 5 women who formed part of the cabinet. Three of the 5 ministers are product of nepotism. Let's look at Dr. Rita Bhaguna Joshi. She's a daughter of former UP CM Hemavati Nandan Bhaguna. Swati Singh, wife of BJP leader Daya Shankar Singh, and also faculty member in Lucknow University. Let's look at Archana Pandey. Archana Pandey is a daughter of former BJP Minister Ram Prakash Tripathi. The UP government also recently announced the draft Uttar Pradesh Population Control Stabilization and Welfare Bill to 2021. Which proposes a 2-child policy, and those violating it would be barred from contesting local body elections, applying for the government jobs and getting subsidies under government welfare schemes. I feel the Uttar Pradesh government's proposed law on population control is unconstitutional as it violates the right to equality and should be immediately withdrawn. The bill will result in people not registering their marriages because of the disincentives mooted by the government, which is likely to make women and children's situations of domestic violence or abusive relationship vulnerable and could result in denial of maintenance and support as well as right to property. Third state, Assam. Did women-oriented schemes work for BJP in Assam? Yes, they did. Poll data shows that women equaled men in voting turnout during the 3 phases of the election. The various welfare schemes offered to women voters both during the term of the incumbent government as well as during the run-up to the election seem to have won them over to the party. This in spite of the fact that this election saw fewer women candidates being fielded by parties across the board. Overall, 82.5% of the men voted in the elections compared to 82.4% women. But there were just 74 women among the 946 candidates fielded by the parties. Incumbent Chief Minister, on the other hand, Sarbananda Sonowal, launched various schemes on February 11, 2021, including, bear with my pronunciation, Vistarita Kananklata Mahila Sabali Karan Yojana, second, Aidyu Handik Mahila Sanman Achoni, and Jivika Sakhi Express. The most talked about scheme of all was Arundhoy. Arguably the largest and the most ambitious government welfare program Assam has ever seen, a direct bank transfer scheme. Arundhoy targets women as primary caretakers of the household. Now, the woman rights activist and writer Junu Bora said the BJP used women's sentiments by wooing them with Arundhoy scheme, free bicycles to girl students after 8th class, and free 2-wheelers to college-going girls. Assam Mahila Sangh President Osomi Gogoi agreed with Bora, and she said that, stating that most women voters in the state were not politically conscious. The BJP took advantage of this. It used various monetary schemes as inducements. Finally, I would like to conclude, and the questions that were raised by my fellow mates on why there's no representation of women, less representation of women in the parliament or in the state assemblies. It's not always has to do with the people, the parties themselves, but it also has to do with a lot with the psychology of the people, the citizens of the country, that the voters towards the female candidates who stand for the elections, which will help answer the questions raised by my fellows on why less representation of women in India or worldwide. Recent research suggests that even it is true in countries with long experiences of women leadership from Germany to India. In these places, much of the public stubbornly resistant to the idea of women in charge. But in general, it's common for beliefs about leadership to default to stereotypes about masculine behavior, leading to unconscious gender biases. This can be present even in people who consider themselves progressive, including younger people like us. Especially young male voters who think that women are already represented in politics because at schools, at universities, they see more of women, right? These days, there are many more female students in college than men. Generally, if you think that gender balance already exists, you are less likely to think it's important to elect women leaders. So erroneous beliefs may lead to biases against women leadership. But political scientists have found that when asked direct explicit questions about prejudice against women leaders, many survey respondents deny their prejudice. That is largely due to social desirability bias. Essentially, it is hard to admit to a belief that's seen as socially unacceptable. Social desirability bias bedevils survey researchers and pollsters in a number of fields where people feel uncomfortable being completely honest, leading to potentially inaccurate results. There's also a common belief among men and women alike that women are too delicate to lead. I don't know why they think that. Female candidates face a more difficult time figuring out what would be a good strategy for to win the elections or get support from people because, you know, deviating from gender stereotypes might be bad for women. At the same time, conforming to gender stereotypes punishes them as well. So it seems very difficult for female politicians to find a sweet spot when they plan the strategy. I feel that one of the solutions to gender equality, when we look at their the women representation in politics, we should not change the image of women or men, but we need to change the image of leadership roles. Thank you.
So Sushmita talked about states that were BJP led, but you also want to look at a state that isn't BJP led, right? And one is West Bengal. The All India Trinamool Congress won under Mamata Banerjee, won West Bengal for the third time in May of this year. They won by 47.94% of the state's vote share. And while their support has been spread across different sections and different regions, largely their success has been attributed to the amount of women that vote for them. Women make up 49% of the electorate in West Bengal. And a large part of Mamata Banerjee's electoral success in 2011, 2016, and now 2021 has been attributed to their support. In return, though, she as a CM has brought in over 200 women-centric policies. So we've talked about the BJP's policies, but AIDC has a number of competing policies also. They have policies including Kanyashri and Rupashri that provide funds for education and marriage. They provide bicycles for girl students. They provide education loans and many others.
So as like Winona, you have already pointed, a huge part of AITC's success in Bengal lies in its female vote base and all these women-centric schemes. So for the first time in 2011, the percentage of female voters crossed the percentage of male voters in Bengal, and the ratio has been rising ever since. While an unfavorable sex ratio still means that the absolute number of female voters is less than male voters, many constituencies in Bengal even saw a greater absolute number of female voters. So it is important to note how the growth rate of female voters has consistently been 2 to 3% higher than male voters since 2011 in both the Vidhan and the Lok Sabha elections. And it's going to keep increasing in the future. AITC's focus on women's issues has thus reaped significant results. So 4% more women than men voted for AITC in 2021 general elections, 2021 Bengal elections, while 6% more women voted for them in 2016 and 2019 elections. In fact, among women, AITC led over BJP with a whopping 13%. So that's pretty significant. So it's evident how the AITC has successfully recognized and won over the potential of growing of its growing female vote base. But the female vote was obviously not uniform throughout classes and castes. AITC led among all female categories except the Dalit and OBC categories in the women categories. And interestingly, BJP led in all male categories except Muslim except the Muslim male category. So AITC's lead was greatest among Muslim men and women both, around 68% each. But across different income groups compared to upper class and middle class women, AITC had larger leads among poorer and lower class women, 18% and 22% respectively. The lead was a mere 3%, however, among the middle class women, and BJP actually even dominated over AITC among upper class women by 2%. So these numbers actually reflect AITC's targeted effort towards garnering the support of lower class women and can be attributed to its popular welfare scheme centered around women empowerment, education, and economic rehabilitation, including many conditional cash transfers like Rupeshri and Kanyashri that Vinona mentioned.
Yeah, definitely. AITC has had a number of welfare schemes. In their manifesto, they've promised universal basic income for the women guardians of every household. They promised working women hostels, widow pensions, etc. We've also discussed the growing importance of women's votes electorally and how parties are now competing to market their welfare schemes towards targeting women, right? Of course, the BJP is putting out many women-centric schemes, but AITC has, and actually has had in the past, many competing schemes. We've discussed the schemes BJP put out, but a number of these were not even implemented in West Bengal because West Bengal already had previously implemented similar schemes. And so, for example, the AITC introduced Kanyashri Prakalp as far back as 2012. And it had two aims. The basic two aims were to ensure that girls stay in school and that they delay their marriage till at least age 18. The scheme aimed to do this in two ways. The first was an annual scholarship of Rs. 750, which was paid annually. And the second was a one-time grant of Rs. 25,000 that was paid after the girl turned 18, provided that she was engaged in an academic or occupational pursuit. In a scheme that seeks to sort of rival Kanyashri, the BJP has promised 22,000 in four installments that are offered to girl students throughout during their schooling. Another AITC scheme promises a fixed deposit of Rs. 1 lakh to adult women from the SC/ST, OBC, and other economically weaker sections. A similarly proposed BJP policy promises the issuance of 50,000 to each family from the SC/ST, OBC sections on the birth of a girl child. Similar to the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, the AITC also ensured that every school in the state had separate toilets for girls. Even in their latest 2021 manifestos, the parties did have similar schemes. So while it shows that the importance of women in the electorate, it also poses the question of whether these policies influenced the results and resulted in AITC winning and BJP losing.
I think that's a really interesting question because, you know, both the parties have rivaling schemes which are similar. So what is it that actually gives AITC an edge over Bengal? So let's start at why exactly parties are rushing and sweating hard to come up with welfare schemes, which are majorly conditional cash transfers for the lower class women, right? So the reason is that according to various studies, contrary to men, women are much more likely to vote for change and prefer a welfare-oriented party, prioritizing access to basic provisions such as healthcare, water, and sanitation, while men lean towards a more infrastructural investment. So it's natural that women will be more attracted to conditional cash transfers and welfare schemes targeted towards them. Yet, even despite introducing more and more competing welfare schemes and even celebrating their successes in other states like Bihar, BJP really, really falls behind AITC. So as observed by Live Mint in the 2014 Lok Sabha elections, and really not surprisingly, women tend to prefer women-led parties. And representation seems to be the key differentiating factor between AITC and BJP's strategies. So AITC is not only led by a strong female representative, Mamata Banerjee, with a strong connect with not only the women, but the lower class public in general. But AITC has also made some remarkable adjustments in West Bengal by reserving 50% of the seats in local bodies for women. It has also always had a consistent record of fielding women as candidates on a higher scale than the national average. And it maintained that record in 2021 elections with tickets to around 50 women candidates, while BJP had given less tickets to less than 40 women. So, like, comparing it to the 2019 general elections, AITC, Trinamool actually fielded 41% female candidates. So these numbers actually are underwhelming. 50 women candidates is around 16% of all candidates. So these are underwhelming, and these numbers are nowhere as large as they should be. But it is still worthwhile noting the other efforts AITC has been putting in. AITC has a good number of female representatives at the ground level, some 10 million ASHA workers who are community healthcare workers, and more than 70,000 Anganwadi who are childcare workers across the states, which is essential in increasing women representation and establishing a better relationship of the women with the party. And this is the aspect where BJP has been lacking behind.
It was quite insightful to listen to both Winona and Riosha, because when I was exploring this entire topic, what I did was I took the data from the 2019 elections mainly related to female voters and female registered voters, and tried comparing it to certain human development indicators and even relevant data on policies and whatever that's out there. And I have made sure that I work on administrative data that's out there. And it was really insightful, because both of you have been successful at defining whether the success of BJP, or for that matter, any other subnational parties like the TMC among the female voters, was due to the well-targeted policies centered around the female voter base. While I was exploring this topic, I tried looking at the actual raw data and trying to create conclusions. It is a given fact that the BJP has a gender disadvantage, as even in the 2019 election, BJP did not secure the top female votes. Of course, they did better than their previous years, but it was still not close to the female vote that votes that the TMC backed or even the INC backed. What I was primarily looking at was whether there was any pattern to certain indicators related to female social well-being and development. And there are also the factors of the amount of funds contributed to a particular state under each scheme, each given scheme. So let me start by stating certain facts. Uttar Pradesh has the largest female voter base in the country, with 14,61,34,603 registered female voters. That's the highest in the country. However, the percentage of female voters over total registered voters is only 59.6%, one of the lowest percentages among states. This trend is consistent with Maharashtra too, the state with the second largest registered female voters, with only 58% of the total registered female voters turning up to vote on election day. It is interesting to note that the northeastern states have even less number of female electors or female registered voters. However, they rank among the top 10 states with the highest female voter over female elector percentage. Manipur, you name it, Manipur, Nagaland, Tripura, Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, and Sikkim are in the list too. So now let me explain if there is any pattern to analyzing the status of BJP in the state by comparing the female voter turnout to indicators such as literacy rate, rate of cognizable crimes against women, female workforce participation, and female unemployment both at rural and urban level. I'm trying to compare the voters' data to the funds, trying to compare the voters' data to the funds utilized in each state of Beti Padhao, Beti Bachao, and the number of LPG gas connections released under the Ujjwala scheme in 2019. And all the data is up to the elections in 2019. Let's look at literacy rate. The top 10 states with the highest literacy rate, only two of the states had a BJP stronghold, which was Himachal Pradesh and Tripura. Kerala being the state with the highest literacy rate, BJP did not win even a single seat there. But the funny part is, Rajasthan being the state with the lowest literacy rate, that's a state where BJP won 24 seats. The female voter turnout was at 78% in Kerala and at 65% in Rajasthan. And the literacy rate that I'm referring to is female literacy rate. I wanted to be specific. Here we can see that female voter turnout was less in Rajasthan compared to Kerala. But the contrast was, if one were to look at the states in Northeast, Mizoram has the highest literacy rate in the region and Arunachal Pradesh has the least. And BJP did not win any of the seats in Mizoram and won both the seats in Arunachal Pradesh. And the female voter turnout was 80% in Arunachal Pradesh. It was much more than what was in Mizoram. Mizoram was at 62%. Moving on to cognizable crimes, rate of cognizable crimes against women. I'm specifically taking the rate of the rate that was issued by the crime bureau. This thing, Tripura is a state with the highest rate of cognizable crime against women, and BJP performed well in 2019 in the 2019 general elections there. This trend can be seen in the Hindi heartland too, where BJP flaunts their might. Rajasthan has the highest rate of cognizable crimes against women and the BJP won the majority seats in the state. Nagaland has the lowest number of cognizable rate of cognizable crimes against women and there's an absence of BJP. Female workforce participation, which is an indicator of growth and development both in rural and urban regions, the BJP's narrative of hyper growth in rural India is being used since their victory in 2014. And it is rural India that primarily votes for the BJP. This is consistent with the results from the data, as the state with the highest female workforce participation is Himachal Pradesh. The fact that urban India has not voted for the BJP is proven by seeing that the state with the highest female workforce participation in urban regions have less political majority. BJP has seen less political majority during the election. If one were to look at economic voting patterns, if they exist in India, the states with the highest level of female unemployment rate, both in the urban and rural regions, BJP has not had a good stronghold there. And it shows that they have, most of the states have not gone for a majority of BJP representation. Let's look at the policy side of the argument for now. I'm looking at the two centrally sponsored schemes. The schemes we are considering are the ones that benefit the female population, the Ujjwala Yojana for women below poverty line, and the Beti Padhao, Beti Bachao scheme. Under the Ujjwala Yojana, most number of gas connections were released to the states with the highest number of women electors. Uttar Pradesh being the state with the highest connections released. This theory stands true even in the case of Beti Padhao, Beti Bachao, where amount utilized by each state. Now, I specifically took the amount that is utilized and not allocated. The amount utilized by each state was highest in states with the highest number of women electors. These states include West Bengal, Punjab, Tamil Nadu, and Maharashtra. In conclusion, this is the point I would further emphasize on. The BJP understood that it is necessary to maintain a majority female voter base to sustain their ambitions at the center and also their expansion plans into the new state legislatures. At the end of the day, India is a federal system. And in this system, the party that influences the majority states is the one who's truly in power. BJP's expansion into certain states with high levels of subnationalism has resulted in failure. However, it can also be said that intuitively that they have targeted female voter base since 2014 general elections campaign, along with the topic of women's safety, which carried on from the Nirbhaya protests that happened in Delhi, and showing that the Indian National Congress and in 2015 showing that the incumbent is not effective in making sure that women are safe in India.
Thanks for that insightful take, Arjun, and everybody else. So far, we've been looking at the kinds of developments in terms of schemes and policies that the state governments and the central government have undertaken in the context of their women constituencies. I will be building on our roundtable's topic of discussion by bringing in two primary arguments. The first, we'll look at how counterintuitively and rather blatantly, Modi has limited women's participation in the public discourse in his bid to push pro-women schemes. My second argument will look at the aspect of financing for gender inclusivity. So I will be giving a bird's eye view analysis, which will be situated at the country level. The first question, as a few of us have already reflected on, is, if the NDA government really wants women empowerment, why are they, and I quote, reluctant to share power with them, end quote. In 2019, the BJP fielded only 11.9% of women candidates, showing their lack of commitment to the women's true political empowerment. But the BJP isn't alone. Annie Raja, who is the national executive of CPI, the Communist Party of India, and the general secretary of National Federation of Indian Women, has said in an interview that all parties, including her own, lack the commitment to field women candidates. What about independent candidates? She was asked. Raja explained that it is very costly for women to mobilize funds. And even when we look at the trend of increasing women participation in voting, it comes from marginalized identities at the intersection. Dalit women, for example, and not the rich urban and middle-class women. And because existing women leaders are constrained due to the broader patriarchal conduct of political parties, they're also, in a way, afraid to speak their minds. So this leads to their inability to, you know, seek greater representation in their parties. And therefore, this reflects in the ability of parties and senior women leaders to field more women candidates. Coming to my next point, BJP's Mahila Morcha National President Banati Srinivasan believes that her party is the only one in India which is committed to women empowerment. The Prime Minister, in fact, has said, and I will quote this, "When we empower women in a family, we empower the entire household. When we help a woman's education, we ensure that the entire family is educated. When we facilitate her good health, we help keep the entire family healthy. When we secure her future, we secure the future of the entire home. We are working in this direction." Now, this comment was made before the 2019 elections and at the launch of the Amma Two-Wheeler scheme in Chennai. This very understanding of women as conduits of economic development has for long been criticized by feminist economists, as it subsumes women identities under the unified model of the household. Yes, the LPG scheme has improved women's health. However, it has also the potential of further stereotyping women's role in the house and precluding their ability to participate in paid employment. Sylvia Chand, who was a British academic of gender and international development, in fact, has criticized the smart economics approach. What we do see, therefore, is that women are further disempowered under the political front of the Hindutva ideology on account of lack of political representation and social economic repression, which pushes them into the role of caregivers and as good subjects of the state. Look at the primary indicator of women's economic empowerment, the female labor force participation, or the FLFPR. The recent periodic labor force survey estimates suggest that only, and hear this, 24.7% rural women and 18.5% urban women are in the labor force.
The data on Indian women's time use from the National Sample Survey Office shows that women continue to perform disproportionate amount of unpaid domestic work, almost 5 hours per day compared to 30 to 40 minutes spent by men. Time and again, we observe that women as a social group bear the disproportionate brunt of crisis. They did so after the twin shocks of demonetization and GST, which the PLFS's FLFPR highlighted. And now the COVID crisis has made it blatant too. Now, this is not to suggest that situation has only been dire after the NDA came into power. I am only trying to suggest that women's stereotypical roles will and continue to be institutionalized by the government through its supposed empowerment schemes and a complete lack of perspective in designing them. Coming to my second main argument of our roundtable's discussion, let me briefly take you through a critical component of our union budget, which is called the gender budget or the gender responsive budget. And this has to have a mandatory allocation of 5% of overall budget estimates. Now, this practice has been in existence since the financial year of 2004-05, which at the outset seems like commendable development in the early noughties. I am only looking at the allocation aspect of the GRP. In fact, some analysis have already indicated that the gap between allocation and actual expenditure is stark. Case in point is the Nirbhaya Fund for Women's Safety, which sees a massive underutilization of funds at 89%. Every ministry of the government has to undertake this exercise of creating a gender-responsive budget. And the GRB, which comes out alongside the union budget every year, has two primary parts. Part A is that of women-specific allocations of 100%, and Part B consists of pro-women allocations of 30% of the overall scheme. What we see in the GRB, the gender-responsive budget, too, is that the portion of women-specific allocations of 30% have largely stagnated over time. Now, even though pro-women allocations have increased, they are rooted in the assumption that women have same needs as men, when in fact the GRB was meant to address the gaps of inclusivity and equity through state financing. In the union budget of 2019, the PM Awas Yojana was highlighted as a women-specific scheme of 100% allocation. Apni Kapoor of the Center for Policy Research says that houses are encouraged to be in the names of women. Okay, all right. But the next obvious question, as she too asks, is who is monitoring this at the ground level? Nobody. Because the state is not truly invested in this exercise, and it is clearly misleading that this is a 100% women-centric scheme. What we are also seeing is the fall in allocation to the GRB. It is now 4.4% in a pandemic year, compared to 4.7% in 2020 and 4.9% in 2019. Critical allocations are being reduced. The Anganwadi budgets, for example, have been consistently declining over the decade, but this hasn't reduced the backbreaking work that frontline health workers have been undertaking. The pandemic has only shown us how central the Anganwadis have been for last mile delivery of essentials, including testing, tracing, and isolating patients. This overall situation displays the lacuna of a gender-sensitive discourse in public finance and governance. This largely impacts also the state provision and delivery of public goods and services, stereotyping and subjecting women to the mainstream interpretation of the household, which was in fact propagated by Gary Becker. Simply put, and now I will be concluding my part, more schemes have not necessarily meant more financing through or priority of gender identities other than the default gender, which is the man. Thus, one of the first steps that we need to take is to be able to bring more women and individuals from the LGBTQ plus communities, the DBA communities, on the discussion table as political representatives. And this, please, should not be tokenistic. The BJP can very much pass the women's reservation bill as it has the numbers. So what's really stopping them? This, as even studies on gender and political representatives and delivery of public services and goods have reflected, will reduce the bias in our society that normalizes and will normalize women as capable and valuable representatives. It will also improve the designing of policies and programs and projects. We shouldn't have to be waiting for so long.
It was quite an insightful session, and I think we'll all leave a little more informed from our discussion today. So to sum up our discussion, I think it'll be fair to say that even after so many women-centric policies and increased women participation in voting, the share of women representation in politics isn't being given the due attention that it deserves. And it's for various reasons, which are essentially psychological. And this gives parties like TMC and Edge over BJP. Perhaps strong women in leadership roles and equitable social programs can work more in favor of the ruling parties. So I would like to end here and thank you all for coming here and sharing your views, and thanks to the viewers for watching.